You're stuck with your family, so choose your friends wisely. Knowing is the same as changing. It's still today until you go to bed.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Let's Play D4. Well, we can hear that music playing, and we know what caused that. That tall gentleman back there. But let's not pay attention to him right now, because something that perhaps requires our more immediate attention is this guy.
What's wrong with you?
He's waiting for Zapatero, who's in the bathroom. Of course, Zapatero is who we need to talk to, so let's talk to Derek and see if maybe he might let us do that. He does seem kind of grumpy. So let's try to open it up with some something topical. Let's talk about the safety of the witnesses.
How's security for the transport? Nice and tight?
You trying to say something?
I'm worried that you might let this guy just slip away from you. Even up here, it might happen.
Mind your own business, boy.
Yeah, I guess that's the only response we could have expected. I guess let's talk about this, continue talking about this subject.
What about security in the airport, then?
Security at Logan Airport is tighter than Fort Knox since 9/11. No need for you to worry about anything.
Alright, anything he can tell us about the courier himself, maybe?
If possible, I'd really like to have a word with him.
The hell you will.
I'll leave you alone. Once I've got what I want from him. Really, I will.
I don't care rat's ass about what you need or what you'll do for me, boy.
I guess, yeah, we're not making any headway at all here. But he does have an extra case available, Derek's D. He's referring to the D that Derek's name starts with. As such, he is kind of a suspect in David's eyes. But let's see what this extra case is all about.
Marshal, I want to ask you something.
I've got nothing to say to a man who abandoned his duty.
Abandoned?
Am I wrong? You quit the force, right?
How do you know that?
I'm nothing like you. I'd never run from anything. I'd pursue my targets to the end of the earth. Never give up.
I haven't given up. There are some cases that can't be solved from inside the machine.
Oh. I'm not sure I'd agree with that. If, oh, let's say, the President of the United States were here, well, then I'd hear you out. See, I'm a real patriot. I'd be respectful in front of the President. I don't see him on board. So get lost.
You think you can get rid of me? Okay. I'll play your game. I'll find the President and stick him right in your arrogant face.
Yeah, that's right. We're gonna go find the President. Let's find him, and then Derek is going to be real nice to us.
Damn.
Alright, where on this airplane might the President be? I mean, we haven't seen him around. Is there any place we could look where we might find the President? Anyone who we could ask if they've seen the President on the plane? I mean, maybe if the President was on the plane, I expect Deborah would have noticed, but, I mean, she's not here now. She was taken up to business class by Philip Cheney. There is a scrapbook here, though, so I guess we might as well take a look at it. It is about hockey, and David does love him some hockey. Oh no, disaster for the Stanley Cup! The Stanley Cup is said to be the most difficult of all trophy cups to win in any sport. Perhaps for this reason, the team winning the cup is given an unusual privilege. This privilege is that the members of the winning team are each allowed to keep the cup in their possession for one day at a time. During this day of ownership, many players use the cup in various ways as a celebration of the victory, but this has led to a number of cases of what can only be characterized as a mishap for the cup. In particular, in 1999, the Stanley Cup was exposed to the risk of theft while on Boston turf. Well, I'm not really sure how that's disaster for the Stanley Cup. That's more like inconvenience for the Stanley Cup.
The Metro M. That's the subway in D.C. The Boston MBTA uses a T symbol, so this ticket was used in D.C.
I think David might feel a bit too at ease with doing that with his gum. But I don't know what evidence this might show us. Well, I already know what this is.
Snow. Cherry blossoms. A seasonal theme, I'm guessing?
That's nothing new. We already found out about that when we were speaking with Duncan. We are kind of low on stamina, though, so maybe let's buy something from the branch shop here. From the cat. Let's buy food from the cat. Let's see, what's the biggest piece of food we can buy? A can of baked beans? Well, that'll do the most to recover our stamina. Just want to make sure that we don't run out and have to go back to the apartment. Oh, vegetable sandwich? Why not? Again, if you're going through this game for the first time, you're not going to have a whole lot of money. And let's finish it off with some dessert. Have a donut with a fancy topping. So you're probably not going to just want to spend a whole lot of money buying food, but I mean, we're kind of rich right now, so I guess it's no problem. Alright, so it's a good thing Amanda's shop was here for us to buy some groceries from. I already looked in there. Where is this president? I mean, I don't think this guy is the president. Pretty sure. Oh, hey, look who it is. Well, maybe he knows where the president is.
The designs in business class are just as atrocious.
You know, I guess that mannequin is kind of a conversation piece. We should probably ask what's going on with that.
Why do you have a mannequin with you?
She is not a mannequin! How many times do I have to tell you? Look! She clearly has a seatbelt on. Oh, Suki, you have the perfect waistline. And unbelievably smooth skin. A human woman could never hope to achieve such perfection.
I see. Real women just don't do it for Duncan. They cannot achieve the state of perfection that someone of his stature requires. Let's ask about the art world.
Sorry, but it isn't really art that I wanted to talk to you about.
So why are you bothering me? Art is the only thing that Suki and I have any interest in at all.
Well, I mean, I guess we don't have too much in common, but, I mean, maybe he knows something that we could use. Let's ask about his sunglasses.
Are those sunglasses Art?
Art that's about to happen, yes. This avant-garde style. I hate to say it, but time is moving fast. The era of retro and military is coming to an end. Finally. This is the cutting edge. This is avant-garde.
Well, maybe he knows something about Zapatero? I don't know what the odds are of that, but let's ask.
Do you remember the two sitting in the seats at the very back?
Whoever do you mean?
When you came and educated me about the seat covers? The two who were directly behind us.
I'm terribly sorry, but most of the time I only ever see Suki. I have no interest in anyone else, I assure you.
Well, he's sort of the opposite of Deborah. Deborah, who notices everyone. Duncan doesn't notice anyone. I guess let's talk about it, the inspiration of his art, since that's the only thing he has any interest in at all.
Where do you get the inspiration for your fashion designs? I find it hard to believe you come up with them while sober.
I don't get my inspiration from anywhere. It can arrive most violently. But it won't come to you by just sitting around and waiting. You have to desperately chase it down. Chase and chase like a dog gone wild. Even a mundane creature like you will understand. Eventually.
Don't try and hide it. What is David referring to?
That's not really what I was asking.
Then you need to make yourself clearer.
I want to know about doping. Like, maybe your inspiration came from the use of certain drugs?
Doping? Drugs? You think I would cheat my way to the top? I don't need drugs! Why would I? I have Suki.
Well, I guess that's what David was trying to get at. Does Duncan know anything about drugs? And does he know anything about this man standing behind us with his fork and knife? Does he know anything about that?
Let me ask you about something else, then. Has that giant been on this flight since takeoff?
Giant? What giant? Are you sure you aren't the one doping?
That's odd. I guess let's start Duncan's extra case, something about avant-garde, since he apparently does not know anything about this tall man who is standing right here.
So, this is the era of avant-garde?
That's not quite right. It is avant-garde! That difference is everything. You have to embrace it.
Okay.
I have to say, and stop me if you've heard this before, your choice in fashion is terrible. An affront to art itself. I never thought I'd meet a man who can walk around happily dressed like that.
Hey, it isn't that bad, right?
Oh, please. It's that bad. Looks like you don't even have the right clothes to go shopping for clothes.
No, go ahead. Tell me how you really feel.
I can't open my heart to those with no understanding of art. After all, spending unproductive time sullies my brain, damages my creativity.
I don't have a leg to stand on with this guy. But I also can't just pass him over. Not with a name that starts with a D.
You know, I'll give you a chance, though. Prove you can get with the dress code, and we may be able to chat. Just one item. Wear one single item that's cutting edge, and come see me again. Oh, my God!
Sounds like a real drag. I wonder if there's anything tucked away in my closet that might help.
All right, we have a new side quest. Duncan cannot open up to anyone who is not down with cutting-edge fashions, so I guess we're going to have to go back to our closet and see if we can find anything that, well, that might impress him. But would we have anything that could impress such a fashionista? I mean, more than that, he's a designer, a top designer. Actually, he's on this magazine right here. Yeah, there he is, along with Suki. It's an interview with Duncan and Suki. Today, we are talking with designer Duncan, a man certainly possessed of a very unique vision, with a passion for retro and military fashion. According to Duncan, the trend for this summer is retro and military. Of course, some might be thinking that retro means dated, and that military has nothing to do with fashion. Duncan challenges such people to take this opportunity to try retro and military. The key fashion items that he currently recommends is a mesh tank top. As it is so easy to match with or add your own accent to, it's perfect for people with no confidence in their fashion. I hope you'll all give retro and military a chance this summer. So, an interview with Duncan and Suki talking about retro and military. Though Duncan did say that his current style is avant-garde. So, retro and military must have been the previous one.
There's nothing here.
Now, look at these luxurious giant trays in business class. Nothing suspicious here.
What evil might I find here?
The Washington Monument, I see. And mini pretzels. There's a glowy. Guess what that glowy is? It's a George Washington doll. That would not have been here if we had not activated the side quest with Derek. So we have found the president and found this man. He probably wouldn't mind waiting a little while longer. We have some business to finish with Derek. And this bear. Now, $59 for a teddy bear, that is a ripoff. I'm gonna pet that bear.
That's one fashionable bear. Not bad for a gift from Washington, D.C.
I guess, but it's not really have much of a D.C. theme to it, does it? And again, $59.
There's nothing here.
Still, I guess that's pretty cheap for something from the Sweryverse. Fire extinguisher. I guess we better try it out.
What am I doing? It's hardly the time to be playing like this.
I don't know. What are we doing? Maybe he knows. But, let's not talk to him quite yet. Let's talk to Derek. And actually, while we're doing this... Yes, I thought so. This scrapbook thought it could hide from me, but no, it cannot hide from David Young. Not when it's about hockey. No, it's the continuation of the story of disaster for the Stanley Cup. On July 2nd, 1999, John Rodriguez, one of that year's winning players, decided he wanted to let the local fans see the cup up close, so he took it with him to TD Garden. At the event, the fans raised a cheer and received John with great applause. However, just as John was holding the cup high overhead at the center of the rink, a man in hockey garb suddenly burst into the rink and stole the cup from John. The man knocked down the approaching police officers and ran through the spectator seats towards the exit. Just when it looked like the thief was about to abscond with the cup of honor, a fan standing in the rink shot a hockey puck off towards the perpetrator. The puck connected with the thief's head, rebounding into the cup itself. The criminal fell to the floor, and an off-duty Boston police detective arrested him on the spot. The person who downed the thief, accidentally KOing the cup as well, immediately disappeared from view, but according to several eyewitness fans, was an amateur player belonging to a local adult team. The detective who arrested the perpetrator at the scene commented, "He showed a tremendous sense of justice and great initiative, but didn't think too carefully about the consequences. I can't say I was too pleased when the cup got hit by the puck." To this day, the Stanley Cup still wears the scars of this incident. have doubts about whether or not that story is true. I don't know. Maybe I'm just too skeptical.
There's nothing here.
All right. Let's head back to Derek. Show him that we have found the president on this plane and see what he thinks about it. Hey. Hey, you.
Hey!
All right, let's hand it over.
I've got someone here who wants to talk to you.
Huh?
Want to give him a hug?
I can't believe you.
Ready to hear me out now?
Maybe if I was five. Childish tricks.
You're looking at the first president of the United States.
File on you was right on the money.
What did you say?
Former number two in the BPD drug control unit. Lost your wife in a real blood-related case 2 years ago. Quit the force as a result. Currently specializes in messing up crime scenes with cheap parlor tricks. A charlatan who thinks he's still a real detective. That's about the short of it.
I'm no charlatan.
Prove it then.
Okay. I'll guess the NHL scores from tonight's game if you like.
Interesting. Then how about this? Bring me a copy of today's Boston Herald. Today's edition should be going out on a newsstand right about now. Of course, we aren't even in Boston yet. Oh, and we're on a plane as well. Now run along and leave me alone.
A change of tactic, is it? Seemingly impossible, perhaps. But not for me, Marshal. After all, this whole place is just the past for me. The past to which I can come back whenever I want.
All right, we got a new extra case, which the Marshal thinks is impossible. But David knows something he doesn't know. But there's a new topic to talk about, witness abduction. David apparently concerned about Zapatero vanishing from the plane. So I guess let's ask Derek about it.
What happens if your witness is abducted before arriving at the airport?
Are you soft in the head, son? How's anyone gonna take him from an aircraft mid-flight?
I don't know. That's why I'm asking. How would you do it?
I wouldn't. Too much hassle. If you just want to shut someone up, all it takes is a bullet.
I guess that's a point. Let's ask Derek what he knows about real blood.
Why are you investigating real blood?
That's my job. Nothing more, nothing less than that.
It looks like a lot more to me.
Whatever it looks like, it's nothing to do with you.
I guess there's nothing else to talk to him about right now. But we can go back to our apartment and find what we need. Not only for Derek, but Duncan wanted us to dress up in something more cutting edge. And we can see if there's anything in our closet that'll help out with that. I'm sure the tall man in the surgical mask will wait patiently for us to get back. All right. There are also a few other things we can explore in this bedroom. After all, we have not taken a look at it back since episode 1 started, so there's a few things that we can take a look at. For one, Did you see that there were clovers on the bed? Yeah.
Hey, baby. You don't have a name yet, so that's what I'll call you. Take everything you need from my body, and then you'll be born strong and tough, just like your father. You don't have to worry about copying his hair, though, especially if you're a girl.
Oh, memories. We've seen in some of these memories that Peggy was pregnant. No, word about whether or not that was before or after she was murdered. Well, that doesn't even make sense. I meant this. No word on whether she gave birth before or after, before she was murdered, because she wouldn't have after, which it's, I guess it's possible that it could, never mind. Let's get that. There's something down here. We got the Boston Herald. Okay, we're gonna shove this in Derek's face, but first of all, there's a couple scrapbooks to take a look at. Oh, animal life. This one's talking about cats and how they blend into human society. In the 21st century, human society is a very complicated beast, but there are still animals who fit right in. Some hide in the leaves, while others have become workers. Still others are famous, while others live as good partners with humans, or family. Out of these animals, cats stand out as special animals who've built bonds with us humans. As members of our families, cats have developed a very clever way of controlling their human hosts. Sometimes they act weak, cute, or look at us with sweet, lovable faces. And other times, they're cold, fickle, and standoffish. Watching them, humans become happy, shocked, jealous, and even feel healed. It's said that cats do not move in packs. As proof of this, tigers and cougars only move in their small family units and do not gang up together. Then, how did it become possible for cats to fit themselves into our complicated human society? All we need to do to answer that question is to look back to the bigger cats. The only animal in the cat family that moves in packs is the lion, the king of all animals. Male lions create harems, and females move centered around their males. Our little cats have inherited that same DNA. My cat is so fickle, I couldn't possibly believe it ever move in a pack. You've heard something similar before, haven't you? But haven't you also seen cats group together at least once? Cats naturally gang up together, claim turf, compromise, and have the ability to adapt to new environments. This is clearly proof that cats, by instinct, have a desire to move in packs. By creating packs, they achieve a more advanced level of social status, which has earned them glory since long ago. This habit allows cats to better understand our human society and allows them to blend into the packs of a completely different species. The reason cats always come out on top is because, just like humans, they understand the importance of compromise. Your cat may seem fickle and selfish, but it's still thinking about the balance of the pack that it belongs to and maybe making some great compromises. Zoologist and cat lover, Tony Okamoto. Well, that was a whole lot about cats. I wonder what that has to do with anything going on in David's life. But hey, maybe something more on movies over here. Sure, it's talking about rotoscoping. Are you familiar with the term rotoscoping? The word may be well known to movie fans, but others may be seeing it for the first time. But we're sure that if you saw it with your own eyes, you'd say, "Oh, I've seen those before." Have you ever seen animation that is sort of squiggly or fluid, as if it's real? Rotoscoping is a technique developed by Max Fleischer, the founder of Fleischer Studios, that involved tracing over planned real footage in order to make animation movements and expressions more realistic. The technique was employed in the 1930 animated movie Snow White and the epic sci-fi film Star Wars, with its famous lightsabers, as well as many TV commercials and commercially broadcasted cartoons. In the 1980s, rotoscoping was also widely employed in music programs, such as music videos on MTV, which gathered a lot of popularity. One of the most representative works from the period is the music video for Take On Me, a single by the Norwegian band A-ha that expertly fused real and animated parts and earned great praise. If you have the chance, we highly recommend you view it. Since artists trace right over actors' movements in rotoscoping, the movements look very fluid and rich, and is a testament to the capabilities of full animation. On the other hand, it requires actors and materials for filming in advance, and thousands of sheets are necessary in order to capture realistic movements. This high cost is said to be the reason why the technique is not often seen in commercial works. However, thanks to the switch from film to digital media, as well as the birth of new digital tools, rotoscoping has once again entered the spotlight. Thanks to the progress of digitalization, hand tracing has once again gathered attention. To the author of this article, who has slightly classical tastes, this is very exciting news. Well, someone really likes rotoscoping. But that really doesn't have too much to do with what we're doing here, does it? What we have to do now is go to our wardrobe. Now, to find something that Duncan considers cutting edge, it's actually a unique extra case in D4 because we can't solve it our first time through the game, because we don't actually get the shirt we need the first time through the game. You see, in my closet, I have this, the avant-garde shirt. Uh-huh. Yeah, there we go. You see, we actually get this from Duncan later on in the game. And then the next time you play the game, you have it at this point, and you can impress Duncan with your avant-garde style. So, let's wear that. And I guess we might as well check out the clean bathroom while we're here. We can look at ourselves in the mirror and marvel at how good we look. It's a great dye job, too, on the hair.
Life sure can be strange. A scratch from a rusty nail kills one guy, while another carries on with a bullet still in his brain.
Yep, life is funny that way. Also, you shouldn't leave money lying around in your bathroom, David. Let's see if he has anything new to say about mementos. Nope, just go straight to this. Alright, let's head on out. Head back into the dirty bathroom. Let's enter the bathroom, actually, instead of just diving straight away. Because... no, still nothing here. At some point, there is going to be something here. David has nothing else to think about, I guess. So, with that, I guess let's dive back into the past. With our new impressive clothes.
You
Alright, Duncan's gonna be standing right out here.
What's wrong with you?
Alright, let's see what he thinks about this newspaper.
Is this what you wanted?
Holy shit. What kind of trickery is this?
A good magician never gives away his secrets.
Huh.
So, why do you only go after real blood cases?
None of your business.
Then we may have a problem going forward. I have certain personal circumstances that mean I can't back down.
Personal circumstances? Look at you. I have a duty. A duty to lay out on a slab every single scumbag involved in real blood. Anyone gets in my way, no matter who they are, I ain't got no mercy. Now get lost before I slaughter you.
Derek Buchanan. At this point in time, I've no proof that this man is D. But so long as that possibility remains, I'll need to keep an eye on him.
Alright, so we don't know one way or another if he's D. What's this about justice?
Tell me, United States Marshal, what is justice?
What do you want to know now?
The belief that drives you?
Anything driving me withered up and died long ago. All that's left for me now is duty.
Huh. Well, I don't know. He doesn't sound proud of it. He sounds dead inside. The only thing driving him now is his job. That's kind of sad.
God damn it!
In either case, he's not gonna let us talk to Zapatero. No use continuing to try to go up that tree, I guess. Let's talk to Duncan and see if we can impress him with our clothes. Alright, what do you have to say about this?
Have you honed your fashion senses?
Well, you tell me.
What about this outfit?
Oh, wow. That's it? You got it. So avant-garde. Perfect. Simply perfect. You are doing well to so thoroughly delight my senses.
Well, you gave it to me.
Suki seems to like it too. I think just this once. You've earned a special present. This special avant-garde new item. Now, maybe you've achieved a sliver of understanding of art. Suki and I always welcome new collaborators.
Alright, so we started a new extra case. And he said he's giving us a gift. And we didn't see anything. That's because I already have the gift. The first time going through this, he gives David the rest of the avant-garde items, which are pants and shoes, so let's head back and put them on. Right, there are the avant-garde pants, which really don't look too much different than the comedian pants we were wearing, but I guess the black and white tones, hues, is more important. Now, while we're doing this, why don't we take the opportunity to change our facial hair? Oh yeah, that's not bad. Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, so many facial... Oh, there, that's a potential one, but I think maybe we should go... There we go, brother. I'm into this. Just, you know, just adding a little bit of our own fashion on top of Duncan's. We can't let Duncan dictate all of our fashion sense, can we? Gotta add a little bit of David Young on top of that.
You trend-setting compeer. I've got the perfect look now.
All right, let's show off the rest of this, these amazing clothes.
Is this outfit avant-garde enough for you?
Oh, you finally mastered avant-garde. The world of art is deep, however. You need to keep pushing boundaries in the future.
All right, so, I mean, even though our style is without critique now, fashion is a very fast-moving thing, and we have to keep track of it at all times. What does Duncan recommend for us?
So, where can I pick up some of this avant-garde clothing?
All of these are original designs from Suki and myself. That makes them the only two in the world. If you really want to dress in the same avant-garde style as us, I think you'll need to come and study at my personal studio.
Wow, an invitation to study under the master. What an honor.
So, the era of avant-garde is gonna be a long one, is it?
I can't state that definitively, no. There are no constants in the world of art and fashion. That which forms the cutting edge is always being pushed further forward. I met a very shabbily dressed man on the flight to DC. But as a result, I obtained new inspiration. Being able to notice those opportunities is what sets the greats apart. Suki is saying exactly the same thing.
Interesting. Well, inspiration comes where you least expect it, I suppose, and it sounds like Duncan is nothing more for us to talk about, so I guess that means that it's time, finally, to talk to this man who's been very patiently waiting for us. We're running low on stamina, but we have enough to push Roland Walken over here and to talk to him. Let's see what he has to say.
What are you doing here? This big fella, I've met him before somewhere, but I can't remember where. My scar is desperately trying to tell me that he knows something.
Hey, enough already! How long you planning on keeping me waiting?
Get my fake guy, didn't I, bitch?
Antonio Zapatero!
There you are! You're this young I've been hearing so much about.
Not like I'm gonna spill the slop on thee, though. What do you need from me? Hey, papi! So how about you die, fucker?
Wait! Antonio Zapatero!
There's no way to stare and truth or dare!
If you wanna know about these, go on a fucking investigation!
Hand over your evidence! Whatever it is! I need it!
Are you serious?
It's so silly!
Then I'll just have to take it! By force!
Hot beverage?
If you really do know who D is, I'll...
What? If I really know, you're what?
Jungling-a-ding-dong!
Oh my goodness! Suki!
You'll get over it!
Yeah, things just got serious.
All right, Zapatero. I'm knocking this one out of the park.
No hitting back at the pitcher.
This is how you use a megaphone. What is the evidence you have? Tell me!
My precious eye was flying! You fucking dumbass!
Maybe, but that doesn't matter! What do you know about D? Tell me!
That really hurt! I'm gonna kill you!
Olivia?
I'm dying. I'm dying. rabbit? The courier, he vanished?
Well, it seems that despite David's best efforts, he wasn't able to prevent Antonio Zapatero from vanishing from the plane. The lightning struck the plane, and even though Zapatero was right underneath David, and he did not seem like he was going anywhere, he's suddenly gone. What could be going on? What could be happening? What did we just witness? I guess we'll have to try to find out next time on Let's Play D4. We'll continue on this investigation of this very mysterious airplane and what happened to the courier rabbit. I'll see you then. Something to keep track of in the fight scene here is the health meter in the upper left, as it finally goes down to zero, and we finally do get to use the rabbit's foot, as well as see what happens when our stamina runs out altogether.
Oh, how about you die, fucker?
Wait!
There's no way to stare at truth or dare! You wanna know about me? Go on a fucking investigation! So silly!
If you really do know who D is,
what? If I really know, you'll what?
Ding-a-ding-dong! Hey. Oh my goodness! Suki!
You'll get over it!
Yeah, things just got serious!
Alright, Zapatero! I'm knocking this one out of the park!
Vanishing voodoo ball. Strike. That's my vanishing voodoo ball.
No hitting back at the pitcher.
This is how you use a megaphone!
Hey there! What you looking at? Fuck you, yeah! Just drink that! Don't try to...
What is the evidence you have?
Just drink this drink! Hey man! I wanna drink with
Tell
me!
You
little My bastard. Precious eye went flying!
Put yourself in the air! Stick this down, you goddamn bro! Yeah!
What do you know about D? Tell me!
gonna kill you now!
If you do have evidence, then it might be a memento!
Just, who are you? I love you.